Geologists have found that the boundary between the Cretaceous and Paleogene layers, called the KPG boundary, in many regions is marked by high levels of the rare metal iridium. While it is true that nearly all dinosaur fossils are absent above this KPG boundary, the areas with high iridium levels are not restricted to the thin zone that defines this boundary. In fact, in the same regions where the KPG boundary was discovered, recent studies have identified a 4-meter-thick layer rich in iridium, not the thin line shown in most textbooks. These studies reveal that there was not a single iridium spike, but rather a horizon of peak values within a sequence of iridium-enriched clays that were most likely deposited by volcanic activity, as well as an asteroid, or series of asteroids. Numerous scientists have taken the stance that these wide bands simply do not support the idea of a simple impact extinction event. In fact, Dr. Keller and other scientists invested over 30 years looking for evidence to support the Chicxulub impact in the Yucatan Peninsula as the cause for the KPG extinction event, and found very little evidence for such a conclusion. Although they found occurrences of iridium anomalies in Italy, Denmark, Tunisia, and India in the context of the KPG boundary, these were never associated with the Chicxulub impact ejecta. Other scientists have also been puzzled to find out there is virtually no iridium in the Chicxulub ejecta material itself, not in the layer at the base of the event deposit, nor in the ejecta layer above. This was not what evolutionists were expecting. How could the very asteroid impact site that was supposedly responsible for depositing all the iridium associated with the KPG boundary extinction not itself have iridium? From a biblical history viewpoint, this makes perfect sense because volcanic eruptions also release iridium, and the resulting ash and dust clouds tend to spread worldwide. This certainly appears to have been the case for the eruptions that produced the Deccan Traps. Indeed, airborne particles above Hawaiian basaltic eruptions have been found to be highly enriched in iridium, at levels much higher than at the KPG boundary. Certainly, asteroids that have impacted the Earth in the past must have contributed to iridium levels, especially in regions where the sedimentation rate was relatively slow and iridium fallout from the atmosphere could concentrate. This would have been true during the flood. However, since volcanism was so voluminous and widespread during the flood, this latter explanation seems to fit the data much better than does the asteroid hypothesis, including intervals that evolutionists identify as great extinction events within their worldview. Next, let's consider the timing of the asteroid impact and the dinosaur extinction. Natural history museums portray the asteroid as wiping out at least 2/3 of all species of life in just days, weeks, and months after the event. However, evolutionary dating now places the impact 100,000 to 300,000 years below the KPG boundary, that is, the point marking the time of dinosaur extinction. This is because researchers now assert that the 30 feet of sandstone west of the impact layer was deposited hundreds of thousands of years before the dinosaur extinction. This obviously pushes the Chicxulub impact back in time well before the extinction. The biblical model, however, does not have any such dating challenges. Biblical genealogies constrain the flood to just thousands of years ago and implies that at least one of the assumptions behind radiometric dating is invalid. The 14 different types of bioorganic materials, including blood vessels, collagen, and bone cells still found in dinosaur bones, also lends powerful support to the biblical timeline. Consistent with the biblical timeframe, both asteroids and volcanism were concurrent with tsunami waves and crustal deformation induced by catastrophic plate tectonics, which was the ultimate driver of dinosaur extinction. These evidences sure point to the rapid and widespread catastrophe of the flood. But do you know what seems even more convincing? Soft tissue found in dinosaur bones. Over the last few decades, scientists have been discovering soft tissues in dinosaur bones. We're talking about over 50 peer-reviewed secular science journals that have now reported 14 bioorganic materials found in dinosaur bones. They're finding blood cells, blood vessels, connective tissue, and even collagen, which has a maximum shelf life of just tens of thousands of years, with some stretching it out to a maximum of 900,000 years. Either way, with a maximum shelf life of less than 1 million years, what's collagen doing in dinosaur bones that are supposedly 65 million years old? Many dinosaur bones are even found unfossilized in places like Madagascar, Alaska, and Montana. Even the founder of the largest dinosaur museum in the world admitted that usually most of the original bone is still present in a dinosaur fossil. Just look at this soft, pliable dinosaur tissue. This type of bioorganic material has been found in the bones of several different dinosaur species. It sure doesn't look like a 65-million-year-old rock, does it? When you step back and look at all this evidence, doesn't it look like the catastrophic worldwide flood described in the Bible that happened just thousands of years ago make better sense of this evidence? Looking for answers about what the Bible teaches about creation, the fossil record, dinosaurs? Download the Genesis Apologetics app from the iTunes or Google Play stores for answers to these questions and more.